disciples, whom we will call the 12 apostles, and sending or commissioning them for a special job that he's about to give them. Now, if you were to look up Matthew chapter 10 in your Bible, you would most likely find a bold-faced heading breaking up, and I'd say interrupting the flow, of Jesus' speech, specifically in our gospel lesson, between verses 39 and 40. I want you to know these bold-faced headings are not part of the original, inspired, inerrant Word of God. They are added by publishing companies to help you in your daily Bible reading to find important sections. Sometimes, and I say in our gospel lesson, they really interrupt the flow, especially of Jesus' thoughts and speech. Such is the case today. We don't have two separate lessons. We have one consistent message that Jesus is preaching to his 12 chosen apostles. And in this message, Jesus is direct and blunt. He speaks the truth whether they or we want to hear it or not. He says that the kind of peace that he brings is not a generic or secular peace, like what the United Nations might strive to achieve. No, his is a peace with the whole world, to be sure. And to be clear, Jesus is the prophet who proclaims peace, the one that Jeremiah foretold. And yet Jeremiah said that we would know this is the prophet when his word comes to pass. Now, what word is that? It is Jesus' own prophecies that he would be rejected, betrayed, and even killed for the peace that he proclaimed. So Jesus is the man whose enemies are of his own household, his own people. His Jewish brothers are the ones who will reject him, arrest him, condemn him, and kill him by the cross. So if the proclamation of peace that they or we expect from Jesus' mouth is a soft smile and a just getting along, well, then Jesus does not come to proclaim that kind of peace. And that way he comes to proclaim a sword, something that divides and separates. The peace that Jesus does proclaim is a peace on earth between God and sinful man. This is the peace of which the angels sang on Christmas Eve, but we just sang moments ago. Glory be to God on high and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. This is the peace of the Lord, where sinners repent of their sin, renounce the devil, renounce all his works and all his ways, and yes, are divided by the sword of God's word from the sinful world that clings to Satan's lies. The peace of God can only come through Jesus' death and resurrection, along with the preaching of that message through repentance and faith. And thus he commissions these disciples, these 12 apostles, to go proclaim that message. With that as our Lord's mission, it is clear that his mission, his message, will divide and sever people from one another. And so our Lord quotes from Micah chapter 7 when he says that he has come so that these family members will be set against one another. And he does not say this lightly. Know that it happened in his family first. His immediate brothers and family did not receive him initially. St. John records that at one time they even tried to seize him and prevent him from preaching because they thought he was out of his mind. Now, wherever this division or distinction is being made, wherever the Lord Jesus introduces particularity, some and not others, it is scandalizing. It is troubling to your conscience, and rightfully so. When we hear that the repentance God calls us to might be denied by us, we should fear. When we hear that forgiveness and peace with God that he wins for us at his cross can be rejected by us, we ought to examine ourselves. When we hear that the universal grace of God in Jesus Christ is not universally received, but that there will be division between those who receive it by faith and those who with hard hearts and directed idols reject it, that ought to rouse all of us from any indifference or apathy. So our Lord says of himself and all who follow him, a person's enemies will be those of his own household. If any of those 12 apostles were falling asleep during their commissioning, that would wake them up. Hey, you there, you have a traitor at your table. You have a snake in the garden, an enemy in your midst. That will wake them up. And with that, our Lord gives 7 distinctions in our text, all beginning with the word whoever. These whoever statements are there to address your conscience at the scandalous and terrifying thought that repentance is rejected by many and that faith in the gospel is denied by many. So here are the tests that the Lord provides to see where your loyalty, your trust, and your faith really resides. The Lord begins with some clarifications on the law. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. The 4th commandment, honoring your father and mother, does not supersede or supplant the 1st commandment. In fact, children may be called upon to call their parents to repentance. That is not dishonoring them. It is honoring God first and foremost. In the same way, if your parents' trust and faith in God is wavering, it is not dishonoring to proclaim the gospel to them, to call them to faith in the mercy of God. Far from it, those who have been made worthy of Christ on account of faith are called to place repentance and faith above all other loyalties. In Christ, your father is not firstly your father. He is your brother in Christ. Someone you may be called on to share that word of repentance and faith. In the same way, Christ Jesus says, whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Once again, the gift and blessing of children, a gift that God himself bestows. This gift shall not become an idol that you worship or obey instead of him. Truly, it would be a misguided love or complete lovelessness to turn a blind eye to the sin or the unbelief of a child and not speak that word of God to him or her. Yes, there is a risk of division and sword and enmity within your household. But dear parents, refusing to proclaim the repentance of sin and peace with God through Jesus Christ, that is far riskier to all involved. Next, Jesus moves from the whoever's of the law to predictions of his own death on the cross and what those who follow him will have to endure. In rapid succession, whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Real life is not lying in a hammock, eating bonbons, resting in shade of a tree on a hot afternoon until I just got back from vacation. No, real life is found in Christ. And real life is only really discovered and realized when you die. Now, by faith, we can believe that real life is yet to come, but then, when we die and live, it is realized. Knowing that Christ Jesus has died on the cross for your sins, trusting that he has, in fact, been raised from the dead, believing that in and through baptism, he has given you this new and real life outside of this world, we are awakened and enlivened to live without fear of death or pain or cross or trial of any kind. Yes, we do not even need to fear the enemies within our own household. So if you should be handed a cross, take it up and follow the Lord Satan will say, these things and people that you love, you will lose them all for this message of law and gospel, repentance and faith, sin and grace. Is it worth it? And the Christian heart says, yes. That message of grace and gospel and faith is my only life and my only work. Take all the rest, believe me that. And with this, our Lord finishes his initial list of whoever's, the distinctions he makes, by pointing to his chosen 12 apostles. He looks at them who will bear his word and his teaching across the world, even to our eyes, through their holy writings. And Jesus says to them, whoever receives you, receives me. And whoever receives me, receives the one who sent me. And that is true of the apostles as they go on their mission. It is true of all who carry Christ's message of repentance and forgiveness. Receive that messenger, and you receive Christ. Receive Christ's message of repentance and faith, and you are receiving the very Father who sent him to proclaim that word. Now that is an empowering and emboldening truth. You may not want to think of your child or your parent or your pastor or even a stranger who calls you to repentance as Christ himself speaking, but they are. And then bear that in mind when it is your opportunity, your duty, to call out that same word, repentance and faith. Be empowered by the fact that if they do not listen, they are not rejecting you. They are rejecting Christ and God's word. So speak boldly and do not fear. But then know what will happen when you do speak. Jesus concludes these seven whoever's, these explanations of the division his word will cause, by speaking of rewards. And that's something we like to hear about, rewards. He speaks of the rewards that will follow the true proclamation of law and gospel. He says, the one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. Now, we would be right to ask, since we're talking about rewards, what kind, where, when? Are we talking earthly rewards or heavenly rewards? Well, the truth is, it is both. But the earthly rewards of a prophet or a righteous person and the heavenly reward of a prophet or righteous person are polar opposites. Just look across both the Old and New Testament to see how prophets and righteous people are treated and what their reward is on earth. They're slandered, shamed, destroyed, attacked, and often even murdered for their faith in Christ, the righteous one. As St. Stephen addressed the Jewish council, which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. So, dear Christians, be aware of the earthly rewards for speaking in line with prophets, apostles, and Jesus Christ. They were all rejected, persecuted, and most even killed. But their heavenly reward will be yours also. Real life, salvation, and rest in heaven. The reward of a resurrected body, living in glory unto eternity with saints and angels, and even our triune God, no longer cloaked in divine mystery, but gloriously visible in all his divine majesty. Now, as surely as Jesus calls upon them to receive his message and the Father who sends it, he gives an additional statement about what kind of shape or form that takes. How great or small is this reception of God's messengers? What kind of fruit of faith in their message is given? The Lord Jesus gives an eighth whoever statement as an example. Whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. So dear Christians, there has been, is now, and ever shall be division on account of the message of repentance of sin and faith in Christ's forgiveness. It's true. true. But in Christ, we do not seek such a shallow peace that is not real. We who are in Christ desire, pursue, and receive a peace that is real, a peace that is in Christ, a peace that confesses or rebukes sin, a peace that proclaims forgiveness even to the one who sins against us. This is a peace that receives such a word from whomever it comes, because such a word of repentance and faith, sin and forgiveness comes not from the messenger, but from God, for he is the one who bestows heavenly and eternal rewards graciously and with fatherly mercy. In the name of Jesus, amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and always. Amen.